Hey guys, this is Eric Weingartner with Weingartner Racing. Might have the mic in the wrong spot as I'm recording this, but whatever. We'll go with it. Today's video is Saturday, so it's an update video day, but I did have that as a little title that I'm going to reveal a secret. So yes, I am. That is in this video. It's coming up really quickly, but I want to start before I do that. I want to talk about this. I keep meaning to do this and I forget. That's why I'm doing it now. If you were under the age of 30, so 29 and down, and you want to become a channel member, I'm essentially almost going to give it to you for free. I was wanting to do this in January, and I just keep forgetting to put it in the video. So here we are. What a channel membership is, usually it costs $150. If you're below the age of 30, so 29 and under, go to my online store. I'm going to put a link in the description. Buy a sticker. The sticker costs $6. And then if I'm going to ask for some proof if you are under the age of 30. And then if you are, you're going to get that membership for that $6 sticker cost. And the only reason why I'm doing that is because I would like to give it to you for free, but the sticker thing itself, whenever you purchase that, I have all that information I need. So I can, it keeps all my members together, is in other words, the best way I could say it. So that, anyway, all that stuff stays together. So buy the sticker if you're under the age of 30 and you're going to get a membership. What is the membership? Well, you get texted information as I'm doing the dyno videos. You also, you usually get discounts and other stuff. So for instance, like on all the PDF stuff, they're going to get them for free. So if they ever want a PDF book for whatever reason, I just email it to you. It doesn't cost you a dime. Everybody else, of course, has to pay. But the biggest thing is you get the information up to date. So for instance, the secret I'm getting ready to talk about, I already sent that to them last week. So there's something to it. And you might say for the rest of you, like, why are you giving discounts to the younger ones? Well, because let's face it, we're aging out. And if we don't have interest coming in, this thing dies with us. And I don't want that. So anyway, plus I really, most of my videos obviously are for educational purposes. So it helps to educate the younger ones. And I feel like, you know, you younger generation truly is having more struggles than even I did when I was younger. So yeah, I think it's good for them. But anyway, that's enough of that. So here's the secret. This is a good one. The 540 Dyno Mule. That's what this secret's about. I am running the valve springs in that engine that I ran in 10 years ago in 2014. That's the secret. And you're like, well, that's a crappy secret. You just made me click on it. Kinda. It's more educational. Here's what I mean. These springs were a PAC 1225, and I had bought them in 2014 and put them in an engine that I used in the 2014 Engine Master Challenge. It was a 477 big block Chevy. Initially when I, after the competition was over, I had them in the engine. I hate backing off rockers. I'm not a fan because I hate readjusting, in other words, especially on those, because the rules at the time said you had to run a, hydraulic roller camshaft, hydraulic roller lifters anyway. So we set them up as a solid roller. So you still lash them like normal, but it's a pain to do. Point being is probably for the first month. So 2014, first couple months, I would roll the engine over about once a month. And then I kind of gave that up after about a year. So for the next 8 to 9 years, that engine stayed almost in the same position, because periodically, maybe once every 6 months, I might think about it, turn it over. But the spring stayed collapsed in the same position, never backed off for almost 8 to 9 years. And they just sat there. And I'd actually made a video, which I'm going to put the link in the description, because what I did is I tore down that 477 and I took off those valve springs and I measured the valve spring pressures from each one of those valve springs. And I put it in a video, and just to see how much actual spring pressure you lose by not backing them off, say during the winter. Well, it'd been 8 years, so I don't know how much longer you're gone. And anyway, several of the people in the comments in the video said, that's great and all, but it doesn't show very much spring pressure loss, because there's your little heads up for that. It didn't lose that much spring pressure. But they said, if you ever cycled that, chances are it's going to show some failures. Well, flash forward a few months after that video, the 540 Dyno Mule is being built. I know it seems like I get unlimited funds, but I didn't have any more valve springs to use, and I was kind of like strapped for cash, I guess. Not really strapped for cash, but I didn't want to spend, you know, $400 for a set of valve springs. So I was like, well, they're here. Let's see if these work. It'd be a good way to test them anyway, so we'll find out. So I put them in the 540 Dyno Mule. Now, I actually set them up at a higher installed height than what they call for. So a PAC 1225 springs installed height is actually supposed to be 2 inch. But if you know, the 540 Dyno Mule has an 820 lift on intake. So I actually set them like up at a 2020. So it's actually got less seat pressure than what it did. Since I had checked the spring pressures on every single spring, I did put the ones that had the most seat pressure on the intakes and the least ones on the exhaust. The dyno mule then ran, and then we now have like 27 dyno pulls on it. The springs are showing no signs that that's the issue. Now, is this a definite thing? No, it's more correlation, to be quite honest with you. I'm not going to pretend that it's not, because it could just be that my camshaft low profile that I'm using in that doesn't require as much seat pressure anyway, so it's not going into valve float because I've got more than, it's got enough of what it needs, even if it was less. But it's, we're taking it to 7,400 RPM, no signs of valve float, and this is a big block, so the valve is somewhat heavy, and steel, of course. So anyway, there's your secret. So if you're wondering, and I didn't, reason why I kept this kind of a secret, because I wasn't so certain this was even going to work. I thought I was going to have valve float issues, have to switch valve springs. And also I didn't want to hear the comments of like, you idiot, why would you do that? That's a failure. You're just waiting for something bad to happen, blah, 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 blah. So I kind of kept it a secret till I knew it worked. So, but anyway, there's that secret. The rest of this video is updates about things coming up, including, hopefully you can see this on camera, these two superchargers, which we're going to talk about here in just a second. But there's your secret. So if you're worried about not backing off your valve springs for the winter, my evidence to this point, and granted it's only been one test, doesn't indicate it's that big a deal. So something to think about. Anyway, let me show you some new stuff in the shop and things that are coming up. It's pretty, pretty cool. Torque Storm sent back my supercharger. For those that are unfamiliar with it, I have an S10 that I use for, I use it for fun. It's street legal. I drive around town and whatnot. But as you can go back and listen to a previous video, this is the stock one that I had initially. And I went to the track about a month ago, I guess now. It actually stuck the plug wire into it, and I wasn't so certain I didn't hurt something, so I sent them off. They actually checked it out and said everything's fine. It was actually fine, so they put it back together. This is this one that came with the kit. Now, I thought they were going to put on a smaller pulley, but it still has that same 325 pulley on it, which is fine. Not a big deal. But anyway, I was hoping for like 3.1. This thing only makes 5.6 pounds of boost. So check the data log, got it all pulled up. It actually pulled up, it did slightly more boost right at the 1-2 shift. So that one, it made about 8 pounds. I think that was right when it was shifting. But for the majority of the run, you could almost graph it from the entire time, 5.6 to 6. So right in that range. That's really not that much boost at all. And the thing is, like, well, that's still boost. You should make more power. Me, on the, because I'm running Sniper EFI, I'm having it take out quite a bit of timing. So it only had 24 degrees of timing. And then also I had another safety in there that as the air temperature goes up above a certain point, it would start retarding timing. So actually it only had 23 degrees of timing. Point what I'm trying to say is the boost probably would have made more power, but since I'm taking out more timing, it's almost as like I'm negating any effects that it might have had. If I did, it was really, really small. It was on gas and non-intercooled. Well, they sent me this one, which you're like, why in the world would you go to a bigger one if you're dealing with that? True. I'm going to convert it to E85. So I have the system to do it. Obviously, I plan to do it initially anyway. So I'm going to drain the cell. I'm going to put E85 in it, change the tune, and I'm going to give it a shot. So I'm going to take it to the chassis dyno with the guy, Dugan, the guy that works for me. And we're going to test this one, the same one I had, but with E85, make sure I get the tune correct. And then we're going up this one. This is the next biggest one that Torque Storm sells. So I think this is a 75. This is an 85 millimeter. You could just look and obviously tell it's vastly different. Vastly different. So it's, I mean, this thing should make some boost. So probably some good amount. With the E85, it should run cooler. So the charge temperatures will go down. And I'm probably going to start adding some more timing, obviously, to get the power back up anyway. And then with more boost, because this thing's going to be pretty good. It'd be neat. Now, not only that, here's where things get interesting. Torque Storm was nice enough to send me the bracketry to do another small block Chevy because, as you know, I have a small block Chevy dyno mule. And I can bolt these on, which, yes, I do have the Vortex supercharger, which I do plan to test absolutely on the LS, and I was going to do it on the small block Chevy too. But I will say, and this is, I'm not bashing Vortex, putting the Torque Storm supercharger setup on is so much quicker, easier than the Vortex one. It just is. So this setup to put on will take me no time at all. The Vortex one, it's going to probably take some fabrication and mount stuff. You'll see whenever I'll do a video showing you what I mean. These are just way easier to mount. I mean, the mounting setup's simple. The way the hat and everything works, it's simple.
it's just easier, and it doesn't require external oil. So these are internal oil. The Vortec actually requires an oil line that's got to feed it and then one to drain. These are just easier. Not that I'm not going to test the Vortec, because I do want to see how it compares against these anyway, but I would love to do it right now on the dynamo. And I actually called Gary up at Dunsmuth Machine Shop and said, hey man, I really want to do this. I'd forgotten there's one small problem, which we're working through right now. His entire fuel system is set up for an NA deal. So he doesn't have boost regulator, boost reference regulator. I don't even think his pump has enough volume to keep up with the blow-through carburetor I was going to try to run. It doesn't have for E85, it doesn't have enough for EFI either. So we're trying to see, maybe I chip in and a couple other people chip in, we can get a better fuel system on there so that we can run the blow-through stuff, because I didn't even think about that at all till just now. So he will probably work with it, and there's a couple other, me and him and this other guy will probably work with it too, so we can get a better fuel system on there for doing EFI and blow-through stuff, just because I have to. Right now, I currently can't. There's just, I mean, he's got something that he can use to do it, but I'm not so certain we won't overwhelm that pump that's there. So what I'm trying to say is I have the ability to do it now. I don't have the ability to fuel it right now. So we will also be testing this on the dynamo as well. Don't forget, Vortec will be tested too. But there's that. But speaking of other cool stuff that came in, check this out. This is the next cool thing. And this is the reason why I really, really wanted to do the blow-through testing soon. Because a customer had sent in this. This is a Hulk 23 manifold. This is by Chris Uratko. I'm probably butchering his last name. Now, I'd already tested the Hulk 23, the 4500 one, and I'm not going to lie, I think it's version 1. He's probably since updated. I'm fairly certain he has. It did not do very well. Now, it maybe not did not do very well because of the engine that I have it on, but because after all, I'm making peak power close to 7,000. I think that one's made for much larger engines. I'm 406, but it's made for larger engines that turn way more RPM. This one is different. I haven't taken measurements yet, but I'm just visually looking at it. That runner is longer. So they have longer runners. And this is also, obviously, you could tell this is a 4150 top. And it looks like the actual area, the opening area here, is smaller than what it is on the 4500, which is great because I think it was just too large, at least for my application. But what I really wanted to do, and he also made an update to that, because I told him, or I called him up and said, man, why didn't you put a notch back here? Because this is where the oil is, by the way, on an SHP. And stock block. Now, little M's are obviously on the side too, but this needed to be. So he did add the slot, so I know it's an update. So anyway, there was a guy on Facebook, and we're, I guess, friends on Facebook, although, anyway, he said he had one. I said, man, I'm sure we'd like to test that. And he said, sure. I said, well, I'm going to probably should port match it. And he actually, which is, this is amazing too, so this thing is just kind of line up. He has a set of AFR 227 competition port heads, which happens to be the same heads that I have on the dyno mill currently. So if I port match it to the heads, then it'll fit his heads. So what I've done, all I've done is I port matched it to the AFR 227. And by the way, if you get this manifold, you're gonna have to grind here because I put it on my mock-up block right down there with the mess, and it wouldn't fit on. So I had to grind this just so I could sit down and fit on. But anyway, got it all port matched, but I really want to see if it's going to beat the other manifolds that have been tested on the dyno mule. But I also really wanted to see what it would do with those superchargers, if it would still make that better, or if a different manifold would be better. So anyway, that's pretty cool, and that showed up. This is the next cool thing. This has to do with my big block Chevy roots blown engine that's being built. The one thing I was waiting for forever was shaft rockers. And it's not from Crower. I had a different company. Anyway. But I called Crower up. They said it'd be about 4 to 5 weeks, and it was. They were accurate. And these are amazing. Crower makes really, really good rockers. These are shaft rockers. These are steel. And I try to always use steel rockers on any time you have a power adder deal. And the reason why is more so on the exhaust. You should at least have them, because it's opening against pressure, and there's a lot of force on the rocker itself. And if there's one that's going to snap, it's probably going to be the exhaust rocker on a boosted application. So hence, I like steel. Obviously, since this is a roots blown deal, it's gonna have boost on it. So we need a good rocker. Now, not only that, these are 1:7 ratio, didn't do anything crazy. I had a different upgrade option I added to this. These right here on the tip, they used to have a needle bearing option, but they've since gone to a solid bushing with a DLC coating, and that's an upgrade because these tips do take a lot of abuse, especially on, again, on the exhaust side from opening up against all that pressure, and the DLC thing really makes it better. So steel rocker, nice thing. And here's the thing about them. Yes, I'm a Crower dealer, by the way, but I'll say this. There are no cheaper steel rockers available that I know of, and these are made in the USA, that are out there. So what I mean by that is these rockers are maybe $100 more than aluminum T&D rockers, and almost the same price as the aluminum Jesse aluminum rockers Pro Series. So not talking about their Sportsman. So they're almost the same price as the aluminum versions from everybody else, and these are steel, which I'd rather have steel. If you were to get T&D sells steel rockers, they are a good $1,000 more expensive than this. And Jesse makes a Sportsman Steel Series, which is still $800 more expensive than this. And their Pro Series, forget about it, way out there, right? So if you're looking for an economical steel rocker setup, Crower's it. Not that the others two aren't great. T&D, I've sold their steel stuff, excellent. Crower, I mean, Jessel's, I've never sold their steel stuff just because my customers really don't want to spend that much money. But I'm sure they're great too. But if you're looking for an economical, but American-made, good quality product for a shaft rocker, Crower has it. So, I mean, I'm serious. These are about the same price as the aluminum ones you see for most people selling. And I'd obviously rather have these. That's even with this upgraded on the bearing. Okay, there's that. Now, this is where the technical part of the video ends. So for those that are unfamiliar with how I do things, from time to time, albeit very rarely, I will give updates about how my son did at swimming. So if you're not into that, totally get it. Totally get it. I'm just trying to keep track of what he's doing, but I understand why you wouldn't want to watch it. Just stop watching now. Don't comment about, I hate when you talk about that. You have a choice now. Just turn it off, and I appreciate that. For those that want to follow along on how his journey is coming, well, that's what this is about. So thanks for watching for those guys. If not, let me tell you about my son. Okay, here's the update about my son and his swimming, because I know some actually do are interested in it. And you're like, I thought your swimming season just got over. Yeah, it's almost like baseball. You guys that have kids that are in baseball, you'll understand exactly what I mean. Like, yeah, fall ball, spring ball, summer ball, it never ends. Swimming is almost a year-round sport. So, for instance, they just, what you heard before was short course. For those that don't know, go to your average pool. It's probably 25 meters or yards, depending on where you're at, long. That's called short. A long course is 50 meters long. So it's the Olympic length. So if you when you watch the Olympics coming up, when they're swimming in that pool, that's a long course. It's actually your time's dropping that because you actually go faster on short course because you could push off the wall, you go faster, blah, 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 whatever. Anyway, long course typically starts now and it goes till July. That's when state is. And then he'll get about 2 months off before he starts at all over on short course, which goes from October all the way to February. He never stops training, just so you know. So even though there's nothing considered off season. I'm just going to tell you, they train year round. So anyway, he had finished his short course and he had his season opener 2 weeks ago in Edmond. And I was really hoping it would go well, but it's really hard to judge the things. And honestly, I see my son, you know, from passing, because as you have a teenager, you hardly ever see him, and it just, they're in and out. Well, he goes to that swim meet in Edmond, and my sister's with me, and he gets off his clothes and gets rid of it, and he's got a swimsuit off, and I was like, my God. And not because he got fat. No, he got jacked. Like, jacked. I'm like, son of a gun. Like, his legs look as big as mine, which was like, wow. Here, I'm doing squats and stuff, and he's doing some weird stuff or whatever. He just got big everywhere. I'm like, dang. Anyway, he goes out there and he had a really, really great, he competed in, she made him compete in a whole bunch of stuff he never does, which is things he hates. For instance, breaststroke. He used to be so good at breaststroke. He sucks. And he'll tell you that too, so I'm not making fun of him, but he sucks. And he did not do good in that. But his 100 free, because they call him, the nickname's King of Free, because that's what he loves and he's good at it. His 100 free was really, really good. Did like a 101 long course.
probably could go faster, but he's been training really hard too, which we'll get to in a minute. Anyway, overall, it was great. So he dropped times on everything except for one thing, and I think it was like 2/10 off, so it wasn't that far off, but he had dropped time because the goal in swimming is you drop time. Last week, when you saw me do that video, I was in Topeka, Kansas, and we've never done an out-of-state one just because it costs so much, which that was a huge... Ugh. Let me describe my event. So my wife, when getting in this argument, if you have a couple, you're married, you understand. She was like, "Let's do an Airbnb." And I'm like, "I don't want to do an Airbnb. We need to get a hotel so we can do a breakfast, because his warm-up times are usually so early in the morning, and most places aren't even open for breakfast, and the kid's got to eat before he swims, because you got to have all that calories in him because he's about to swim a lot. I mean, more than a mile, if you think about it like that." So she books this hotel, the Holiday Inn there in Topeka, Kansas, off the highway. Don't ask me which one. I can't even remember. And because it has a continental breakfast, I'm like, awesome. So we show up at this hotel, okay? We show up at this hotel. We get there, and they're like, "We want to inform you that the elevators are no longer working. The ice maker took out the elevators." Which in my mind, I'm like, you know, I'm not an electrical engineer, but I think they would be in a different circuit. Maybe not. So anyway, she's like, "You're going to have to use the stairs." I was like, "Okay. Are we like on the first floor then?" "No, you're on the fourth floor." I was like, "Fourth floor?" Now, to my wife and son, not a big deal. But I'm like, man, I just did a squat workout that day. And I'm like, I do not want to climb these stairs. But we did it. But then it gets worse. I'm like, "Okay, well, what time's continental breakfast? What time's the breakfast?" "Oh, the breakfast starts at 7 a.m. 7 a.m.? What world do you live in? Okay. By the way, this room is not cheap. These things are like $150. Used to be like if you had a $150 room per night, top of line. That's getting you a dump now, it seems like. So I'm like, what? 7 o'clock? What business person eats breakfast at 7 o'clock? They're going to get up earlier. I thought they would have it start at 6 because most hotels start at 6. It seems reasonable because people are gone by 7 or 8. I was like, well, his warm-up's at 6:45 and it's going to take his time to drive there. So that's impossible. Thank you. So now this hotel is really horrible. But anyway, had to get McDonald's breakfast for him. Got breakfast burritos and things so he'd have energy in him. Anyway, at Topeka, the swim meet is have people from Kansas, people from Arkansas and around the area. Oklahoma, we try our best at swimming, but it's definitely not the focus of Oklahoma, the state of Oklahoma. So for instance, our fastest swimmer in the state of Oklahoma was there, and he was getting beat by like 6 seconds. But remember, in swimming, it's not about how you compare to others. It's if you could just beat your time, because eventually you'll end up being faster than them. Well, as we're at this pool in Topeka, Kansas, they've got a list of people that have qualified for Olympic trials. And they have like 8. We don't have one from Oklahoma. And that's just one other club. So I imagine others probably have others. Anyway, the guys were fast. So Bishop's in the pool with these guys, but he's just trying to do his thing. And it was bad. There's no other way to describe it. And I don't even know how to tell you because I feel so bad. He did bad. And it was so tough to watch. What I mean by that is, we'll do with the worst one. We'll do one of them. He did his 50, which I was like, I knew he was struggling. He was tired, which 50 is not as fast. He's not a sprinter. He's a mid-distance swimmer. And I think he did like a 29 even. I was like, what? What is that? Because the week before, at Edmond, he did a 28:46. I'm like, how in the heck did you go a half a second slower? But he told me, he was like, well, the block acted up, and he did break the blocks pushing off, so whatever. But then I was like, still seems slow. Well, then he does his 100. Remember, the week before, he did a 101, fastest ever. He does like a 102 almost, like a 101.99, like a second slower from a week ago. And it just looked rough. And then the thing, his event he's best known for is usually the 400. And he'd done his fastest he'd ever done was a 4:46. And that was a year ago. The swim looked horrible. He did a 5:02, which is bad. That's way bad. Just to give you an idea, 4:46 and a 500 translates to like a 5:05. He did a 5:03 and a 500 at in February. So he's so far off this mark. And watching him swim was like,
I was like, what has happened? His form, he looked sore, and his form looked bad. Like, usually he's got the best form. It really looks smooth in the water. This looked like he was tired and tense. And the reason for all that, for me telling you this, is because he was. So I figured it out. Because he's been doing swim meets on the 3 days, he has been swimming nonstop every day. When he did that meet, he had swam for 21 straight days. No days off for rest. 21 straight days. Not only that, every other day was two-a-days. 2 hours in the morning, and then 3 hours in the evening. Every other day. 21 straight days. Right now, currently, as I'm recording this, this makes day 28 straight. Tomorrow, he finally gets a day off. 28 straight. So I can honestly say he was exhausted. He was swimming exhausted. He just didn't have anything left in the tank. You could just kind of see it. But as a parent, it's like, man, I feel so rough. I feel bad for him. I'm like, man. And I know he saw it too, and he was so disappointed when he saw his time. He was just bummed. But his coach, I love his coach. And his coach was like, come up and talk to us in the stands, and had a lot of words with her or him. And was saying, hey, this is just a step. Don't think that, worry about this. This is just the beginning. This isn't summer state at the end. This is to get you there. You're going to get worn out during this time. You're absolutely going to get worn out. Once we start getting closer to the actual competition, like the major competitions, you'll start dropping off, which I totally believe, because they can do something called tapering where they start practicing less, not necessarily less, but less intense, and their muscles start recovering and they get super, super fast. So I think in the end of the season, that's going to really pay off. Right now, it's just hard to watch because he's like, you want it right now. And she came and talked to us up in the stands. His coach was a woman named Lynn. Phenomenal. Phenomenal. I trust her completely. I know she's got everything in mind for him. But yeah, he's really training hard. And the reason why he looks so yoked up, he's training all this. Well, he's up to like almost 186 pounds. He's up almost 11 pounds. It's not fat. It's muscle. And I mean muscle. Because when I saw him, I was like, good God. If you don't do swimming, you're going to do powerlifting because you're going to break every record I ever had. So this, I mean, he's got it. But anyway, there's your swimming update. He next swim meets in Bartlesville. And yeah, that's the place that got hit by the tornado. Anyway, so he's going to do that. I think it's in 2 weeks. So he's off. Tomorrow is his first day off. He'll get next Sunday off. Then he's got a meet. And then he'll have a few more weeks off. But then we go to this. This is huge. I didn't even brought this up. We're going to Indianapolis in June because they have the Olympic trials. He did not qualify. We're going to watch. And this is amazing. His swim club is going there. Now, it's not cheap. I'm not going to lie. We sent like a fortune. You think race cars are expensive? This is expensive. We're going to watch the Olympic trials in Indianapolis, which is huge. By the way, it's in Lucas Oil Stadium. So if you go to PRI, you already know how to get there. Yeah. Anyway, we're going to go to watch. He's going to go to there. But right after that, we're going to stay for like 3 days because then he's got a meet in Missouri. But anyway, yeah, there's your update. So guys, there's a swimming thing. I won't have anything next week, so enough for that. But thanks for watching. I appreciate all the guys that stuck with me. Yeah, a lot of cool stuff still coming. I don't know how many videos is going to be on next week. I really don't. And since you made it to the end, I'm going to ask the question because then you can comment on this one. What video do you want to see on Monday? I'm going to give you two choices. The beginning stages of porting an LS3 head, stock one, or how much is a port match worth as far as horsepower numbers? You have your choice. You put it down in the comments because you made it this far. You're a true fan anyway. Put it down there in the comments, and then I will do that video on Monday, but I probably will not do another video the rest of the week. I usually do ones like Wednesday or Thursday. I'm probably not. I'm just way, way behind. I need to make money. Let's face it. If swimming's expensive. Everything here is expensive. Got bills to pay. You know what I mean? So, and also I'm behind on customer stuff. So anyway, guys, remember, I do not port cast iron heads. I am no Superman. You guys take care.